नमस्ते एवरीबॉडी, हाय। जस्ट ऐड परिणी।
हाय, हाउ आर यू? ग्रेट
हाय, वेरी गुड. हाउ आर यू?
ग्रेट, वेरी ग्रेट। ओके, सो आई थिंक देयर इज अ फ्यू मोर पीपल जॉइनिंग। वी कैन वेट फॉर लाइक 10 seconds मोर।
राइट,
एंड या
लेट्स गेट दिस इंटरेस्टिंग टिल देन.
ओके, सो ग्लैड टू हैव यू टुडे। थैंक्स सो मच फॉर जॉइनिंग अस।
सेम
सो
यू. थैंक
नमस्ते
यू फॉर हैविंग
एवरीबडी।
मी.
Of course. So namaste everybody. My name is Panasti Vora and I'm the co-founder of the Creative Toli. So the Creative Toli is basically a one-stop desi creative industry network for creative freelancers and professionals to connect, collaborate and create within the industry and the community on work projects and even passion projects, and just, you know, create together as a community. This is a place for creatives to learn, earn, grow and work from anywhere. So continuing our Kala Baithak sessions for this month, today is session 7 and we have Dr. Parinita Shah with us. She is a dancer, an actor and also a physiotherapist, and amongst more things actually. And that's like, yeah, so I'm going to give a small introduction of hers and then we'll start the live. So Dr. Parinita Shah holds a master's degree in performing arts. She has been professionally performing since the young age of 11 and so far has performed all over the country for various cultural organizations and many festivals such as Kala Gujarat Festival, the Elephanta Festival, just to name a few. She's also trained in contemporary hip-hop, Latin ballroom and folk dance. Like, that's amazing. And also having dabbled with acting as a hobby, she's worked as a professional actor and model in numerous ad films and short films and also won like various awards in film festivals. And yeah, a few of her short films are available to watch on Disney Hotstar, so make sure you catch those. Also, she's also a practicing physiotherapist and she specializes in the field of neurology and is also a mat work Pilates teacher. Yeah, with so many talents and multiple facets to her personality, Parinita is also a devoted teacher, artist and therapist with a burning desire and goal to keep her passion alive along with her profession. This has been one of the most extensive intros you've given. Like, it's like a never-ending, just line of things that you've done. Like, it's really, really great to see you achieve so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. That's very sweet of you.
Yeah, so we're really glad to have you here today. So let's start. So can you tell us a bit more about like how your journey started, about like dance and acting? And were you always into dancing in theater as a child, or like how did it all begin?
As long as I can remember, I have been dancing. I think I must have been 4 when it all started. My parents kind of noticed that I enjoyed music a lot and I was always dancing here and there. So they thought, you know, if she really enjoys it so much, why not get her formally trained? So at the age of 5, I think I joined Bharatnatyam and I did it for a couple of months. But unfortunately, I felt very sick back then. And the doctor said that don't continue any strenuous form of physical exercise or dance of any sort. So we had to take a break, and then few months after that, my parents said, okay, not Bharatanatyam, maybe Kathak, let's see whether she enjoys that or not. So then I started learning Kathak, and since then haven't looked back, at least on the Kathak front. That's where it all started. I think I must have been 6 when I started taking Kathak classes.
That's so young. That's
yeah,
great.
Yeah.
Wow. So, I mean, pursuing so many things, like you're pursuing dance, acting, physiotherapy, like, did you feel any pressure around you to, you know, just like doing so much at once? Did you anticipate any challenges? And if so, how did you overcome all of that?
It was definitely challenging because pursuing 3 things together, requires tremendous hard work and time management and
Yep,
sacrifices
yep.
and so much more, so much energy that needs to go in it. But it works out if you know what you want to do, if you've streamlined your thought processes. And of course, I was very, very fortunate to have a very good family support, my parents, my friends. Everybody just came in
That
sort of together to help me achieve what I wanted to achieve. So of course, it was challenging, no doubt, doing three things together, but you kind of figure a way out if you really want to do it, is what I feel. That's what kind of happened. So yeah. And it was in my mind that I wanted to dance come what may. So when I decided that I wanted to be a physiotherapist, this was way back in school, I also thought that, you know, I want to get into the field of healing as my profession eventually. But I don't think MBBS would be a good option for me because that would mean a lot more time to put in into studies, and that would mean a little less time for me in putting into dance, which I wasn't very sure if I should do that. So I was like, okay, no, I will study just enough to get into a good physiotherapy college, and I will ensure that I dance alongside. And acting just happened by chance as a product or extension of dancing eventually. That wasn't on the agenda at all.
Okay, so it's a happy
Yeah.
coincidence.
Yeah.
No, that's great. But yeah, that where there is a will, there is a way, and I think you've sort of proved that to all of us. Because I can't imagine myself doing so much at once. Like, I just don't know how you've done it. And that's really, really, really amazing. So yeah, like, I mean, obviously doing so much, you must have met so many people along the way. You must have, you know, encountered, a lot of people and, you know, met a lot of like inspirational people as well. So how have you met such people that have, you know, sort of impacted your journey as a creative person? And, what's that been like?
I think the foremost, most inspiring person I was fortunate enough to meet was my dance guru, Srimati Asha Jogrekar. The reason, the kind of artist I am today is because of her, because that's the artist she molded me into. She was my number one inspiration that I wanted to be a good dancer because, you know, that's the kind of person I saw, that's kind of artist I saw her to be. And I aspired that. Apart from her, of course, her daughter, Archana Tai, a brilliantly amazing dancer and teacher. She was a great inspiration. Some of my seniors who I grew up, you know, looking at while I was learning dance, they were fantastic. So I met these people at home itself, I would say, at my institute. Apart from them, of course, as a child, you see so many various performances and artists, and each and every one I feel leaves some kind of an impact on you if you really, really like that performance.
Yeah, I
So
agree,
it would
yeah.
be difficult to, just name a few as to who has inspired or impacted my journey, but these would probably be the topmost. And then there are, of course, so many more and more and more people
Of course.
that add on to, yeah.
So where else do you get your inspiration from? Like, if suppose if you have to come up with your own Kathak piece and, you know, other, like just one example, like stuff like that, how do you get inspired to make all of your work?
It's never the same every time. There's always a different idea or thought or observation that suddenly leads to this thought. Oh, okay, wait. I thought this. I saw this. Maybe I should put that down, and then maybe I should convert that into this. It sounds very abstract and weird and very haphazard, but that's exactly how it goes in my mind. But I'm guessing as an artist, everybody will pretty much say the same, that there is no process or a fixed route to creating anything. You can get inspired by
That's true.
absolutely
Yeah.
anything
Anything.
randomly, which is not even
Yeah.
connected to your art
Feel.
form, or say
Yeah.
dancing or acting or anything. And it just goes like, oh, maybe I'll pick this
Right.
piece, I'll pick this thought, and I'll elaborate it and do something on that. So, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
That's,
Yeah,
but
that's
of
true.
course,
That's
I think,
also.
but I
No,
think
continue,
observation,
please.
that would be, I think observation, that would be one thing that really, really helps to create or to come up with something. The more you observe, the more you see things, anything may be, that kind of just leaves like a thought behind, ki, huh, different or usual or whatever. And that's how it just, I think, starts.
Yeah, and you never know when that observation or whatever you've seen sort of comes back to you. And then you sort of, you know, it sort of changes the way you think. And that's really important to be observant, like no matter which creative field you're in. And yeah, that's some, that's really, really good advice also. And yeah, so again, like Kathak as a dance form is very disciplined, right? I mean, there's a lot of mudras, there's a lot of like different postures. So like, I'm sure that discipline also sort of translated into your life as a person. And you know, how important was that to improve yourself in terms of Kathak and, you know, even acting and all of that? Like, it's a very I mean, it's all interlinked, right? So how did
it's
that help
interlinked.
You so how did that discipline, how important is that discipline like to have?
I think that's what a classical art form sort of pushes you or prods or builds into you, the discipline aspect. So what happened was, probably because of that discipline, I was able to do all these three things together when I was studying, learning, growing. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been easy to manage all the
right.
three fields together. So it's very, very important to do riyaz on a regular basis, every day, thrice a week, whatever you feel is regular. Of course, every day is idealistic, but it's very, very important to be consistent and do it regularly. And that discipline
right.
sort of starts automatically shifting into your everyday life. You know, you start thinking about your day in a particular manner. You start penning things down. You start building it or sort of creating your own workspace and your mindset also in a very disciplined form. And that happens, it happened probably because since childhood we were trained to do a particular thing consistently, because that's how it works. Otherwise, mastering
right.
any field is not possible unless and until you're diligent, consistent and disciplined. So that
yeah.
sort of pushed and helped to, you know, achieve or grow or learn things in the other fields as well, be it acting or physiotherapy. So I think it all started
that's
with that
true.
Kathak or that dance bit, and then it just sort of...
Yeah, it sort of left a mark on all the creative different fields in your life, and that's really great.
Probably,
I mean, yeah, like having discipline, and I think that's really important considering you've done so much. If you didn't have that discipline, I don't know how you would have managed to get everything done. I mean, like 3-4 things that going on at once, that's like absolutely insane. So yeah, so now, I mean, we have a running theme for this month, like we have for every month. And our theme for this month is having creativity and purpose, which in turn helps you find your purpose in creativity. So I want to ask you that, have you found your creativity and purpose? And if not, then what are you looking for? Like, what are you striving to achieve?
I think that would be a very, it's an ongoing process. It's not something that will be achieved in one sitting, or it's not like, okay, I've decided to do this today, so this is my purpose.
Right. No,
I
of
think
course,
with
yeah.
every stage in your life, you sort of tweak that and you keep, you know, adjusting and changing according to that. But I feel one incident that really impacted and helped me realize my purpose in terms of creativity or what I wanted to do with art forms in general was, I remember I was 18 and I got this opportunity to perform at a really huge event which had an audience strength of, I think, almost 8,000 or 9,000 people. And at that age, it was a big deal for me that I was getting this kind of an opportunity where I would be performing in front of such a wide, large audience, and the kind of preparation I had to put in to be that good, to be, you know, confident and pull off such a grand performance all by myself,
right.
because it was a solo. It wasn't a group it wasn't a
That's
huge, it was just me on stage. Super,
right.
super intimidating at that point in time. So that sort of happened. And what led to the story that happened after that is what really impacted me a lot. So there was this driver who was assigned to pick me up from wherever I was coming and to dropping to the hotel and to the venue and back and everything. And when he first picked me up from the hotel to reach the venue, he was very grumpy, I would say. Wasn't very friendly, or you know, he was keeping to himself. And I have this habit of, you know, just being polite and asking questions that, you know, what, how are you, what do you do? It's just general, I feel it's courtesy.
Yeah,
so,
it's like conversation.
Conversation, yeah. And you know, I was very excited, so I was very, very chirpy and all over the place. Okay, this is what am I doing here? What is this? And who is this? And blah 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 blah. But
right.
He was very reserved. And after the show got done, we were heading back to the hotel, and he opened up so much, and he goes like, "Can I say something, ma'am?" And I was with my mom because we were both in the car, and he goes like, when I was told that I was supposed to pick you up, I was very upset because I thought I would be on duty with the people who actually made this event happen, who are actually important, and I didn't want to go and pick up a dancer who is an artist. And you know, the value or worth of a person who dances and performs is just entertainment. And I wasn't too thrilled with the fact that I was doing this kind of work. And I have a daughter. And she loves dancing, but I beat the dancing out of her because I don't think it's a very good thing to...
oh, my God.
You know?
To
and
pursue
what
or
he
something.
Said after that, to pursue, yeah. And what he said after that touched me so much. He said, after I've seen you perform today, I'm not going to stop my daughter from doing that. The first thing I'm going to do is go and put her into a class and let her learn that form, whatever it is that she wants to do, because I've realized that it's not always lechy, it's not always indecent, it can be so beautiful and soulful. And thank you for bringing that change in me so that I could help my daughter do so. And oh my God,
that is
I cried
amazing.
And
that must have felt so good. Yeah,
absolutely.
Wow.
Because and that helped me realize that maybe this is what I should be doing. I want to impact and change people's lives in such a way that at least they can you know, sort of be okay with following and pursuing things that they really love. And I want to have that kind of an impact in somebody's life. So maybe the whole teaching bit came from there, that this is the best way that I can reach out to people and change somebody's life or help them in whatever way, realize their passion or love towards any art form. And that I felt was the beginning of my journey towards finding purpose in my in creativity. And
that's
great. It's great.
That actually sounds beautiful. I mean, that whole story, the way, like, obviously the way you must have felt at that moment is like indescribable, I guess. That's really great to that you sort of went through that experience. So now you know, okay, you know, I can do this. I can sort of change someone else's life. And yeah, I mean, I don't have a lot of words to say about this story because it's just, yeah, it's amazing. Again, like stuff like this performance you had where you were alone, have you had any more encounters like this, any more experiences when you've taken part in different festivals, even acting? If have you met, you know, people, and you know, just some interesting sort of anecdotes, if you could share some with us.
Of course. I mean, every performance, every festival, be it acting or be it dancing, you always tend to have a lot of interesting takeaways after that. But I do remember this one very interesting, challenging, difficult, yet fun performance. So this particular performance was on my bucket list for a very, very long time. And it was a prestigious event performance that was organized by a very reputed company. And I got the opportunity to perform on that stage. And when I spoke to the organizer, they told me that, okay, ma'am, so we are giving you a time slot of 40 minutes. And so this is how it goes. And this will be live. And this is what you do. And this is blah, 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 blah. And I was like, thrilled that, oh wow, okay, I get 40 minutes, I'm going to prep, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and blah 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 blah. I put it all in my head. We started working towards it. A month went into the prep and putting things together and practice and hours of sweat and everything. And just I think 4 days before the performances, I ended up having a tiny accident and ended up injuring my ankle with a grade 2 sprain and ligament injury.
Oh
I'm
my
like, oh
God.
my God. Now here is this dream moment which I want to go and live, and now I have this
Right.
bandage around my ankle. How am I going to move? We managed somehow. My friends, they came and helped, and my physiotherapy colleagues, they helped me tape me up, and you know, like, oh, it's fine, you can do it. And my family and friends, everybody encouraged and supported. And I was like, okay, fine, no, we have to get this done. Cool. All that hard
Right.
work, everything, it can't go waste. So we started with that. I reached the venue. When I reached the venue, they go like, ma'am, there has been some change. From 40 minutes, your performance has now been cut down to 30 minutes because we have a time crunch. So now you have to do 30 minutes. Anybody who
Right.
knows Indian classical dancing knows that it takes time to build up a performance. You can't have a 3 minute,
Right.
4 minute, 5 minute performance. I mean, you can, but it's not as effective or good
Yeah,
as a
there's a
long
story and there's a
performance.
whole like
There's a
thing
whole,
going, yeah.
yeah. So you need at least half an hour to 40 minutes to, you know, to like get into it, and the audience then eventually starts enjoying and having a good time. So I said, okay, fine, 30 minutes, no problem. In my head, I'm thinking, हाँ कोई बात नहीं, मेरे पैर पे थोड़ा और कम स्ट्रेन गिरेगा, 10 मिनट कम हो गए, कोई बात नहीं, ठीक है, 30 minutes we do.
Yeah,
So
yeah.
I'm in my mind prepping, okay, how, what do I cut, what do I not cut, what do I do, and I'm getting ready alongside. Half an hour goes by, an hour goes by, and someone comes from the organizing team again and goes like, ma'am, sorry again, but this time it's going to be only 20 minutes and not 30 minutes also, because we
Oh.
have some more issues coming up. I said,
Oh my
okay, now
God.
this is a problem. 20 minutes. How am I
Right.
supposed to cut a performance of 40 minutes down to 20 minutes and, you know, put it all out there in front of the audience? It's fine. Okay, we'll work it out. Now, at this point in
Right.
time, my musicians are in another place. I'm in another place, and there is no coordination between us. I haven't been able to converse and tell them also that, sir, we
Oh,
have to
the
now cut
time.
it this much, so now you have to do this. Don't, you don't play this, don't play that, do this, do that. And I'm like, okay, we'll just do it live on the spot. Jaise jaga waise dekhte hai. You know,
Oh,
we
wing
just do
it,
it,
just wing it.
you just wing it. I'm now about to go on stage. 2 minutes away, I'm literally in the green, you know, in the wings, sorry, not green, I'm standing in the wings, trying to focus, push in all my energy and go like, okay, this is live, we can do this, we'll do this, that, that. And I'm trying to channelize and focus on my thoughts, and somebody comes and go like, ma'am, I'm like, yeah, just 5 or 7 minutes. I'm like,
How is that even
okay.
possible? Like how
Yeah,
can you
in
cut
my head,
down
I'm
a
like,
40-minute performance?
to like 5 or 7 minutes, even 10 minutes, okay, fine, even 10 minutes, but what? I'm like, we'll figure
Right.
it out now, let's just go with it. And I just went on stage. I probably performed for 7 to 10 minutes, maybe, or say, must
Right.
have overshot that time limit and gone up to 15 max. But
Right.
at the end of the performance, the reaction from the audience, the applause, that feeling when somebody stood up and yelled, "Why is this so short? We want it longer. We want to see more of this."
Oh.
That,
Wow.
for me, I was like, huh, okay,
That must
all
have made
right.
up for all of the tension you went
For
through.
all the,
So.
absolutely. So, but this is how it is. This is not just one time. This happens many, many times in every artist's life at some point in time for some performance or the other.
Yeah.
You have to be on your toes, quickly thinking. And this is where the discipline comes into the picture. If you've been
You
doing
still learn to adapt.
Riyaz,
Yeah.
you are able to, you know, sort of wing it and try to at least carry it forward and try to make it as fine as you can.
Yeah,
So,
yeah. That's oh God,
that's
this
how it
story
is.
is just you just got one great story after another, I think. Do you have any more? Please, please tell us. It's I'm sure everyone would love to listen to them.
All good.
Okay, great. So
Yeah.
I mean, working as like now coming back to all of your different professions, what has been one of your favorite projects to work on? And what kind of projects do you look forward to working on in the future?
Favorite projects? I think when it comes to acting, it would definitely be my first short film. It was my first experience as being a lead on a set, which was a story. It was a story between two characters, and that was the scene. It was just two people having a conversation with each other, and that I think is one of my most memorable. One of my favorite experiences or performances. The second
Right.
would probably be the first commercial, maybe what I shot for. These are all very special moments. Your firsts are always so very special because you know, I can see somebody saying the breakup. Yes, that was the first short film.
Is it anywhere online? Can we watch it anywhere?
Yes. It's on YouTube, and I think it's going to be streaming on Hotstar very soon as well. And some of the short films are on Hotstar as well already.
Right.
So if you just type out the name or my name or the director's name, you'll see it pop up.
Okay, that's awesome. Okay, so guys, anyone who wants to find her work, please just search her name, which is written in the pinned comment on Hotstar. You can find all the different short films that she's been a part of. And I'm going to do that once this live is over because, yeah, I love watching short films. So definitely going to do that. So, yeah, that's any more projects? What do you want to, like, work on in the future? What are you sort of looking forward to?
I love fusion projects. That's one of my favorite areas of dance where I really like to keep on doing different things. But the goal is always to maintain the art form in its truest or in its purest essence and form. But then at the same time, you know, collaborate with different artists or styles, be it dance, be it something else, be it music, be it writing or anything, and then come up with a concept together while trying to retain the art form in its original capacity. That is something which really makes me, okay, you know, this I have to work on this really well. This is something that really gets me going. So
So what kind of fusions are these? Like, can you tell us a bit more? Like, what exactly do you mean by a fusion in this context?
Fusion. So, for example, recently I was just having like a jamming session with a drummer. So drumming is not Indian classical, of course. It's a completely different kind of music system. The beats are different. The way it's done is very different. Classical follows Kathak follows a very different format of counting beats and everything. So now trying to find a connection between the two, at the same time retaining the drum's rhythm pattern, retaining the Kathak rhythm pattern, and having something in common. So that is a fusion where we're retaining the original or the essence of the art forms as it is, but yet finding the
but
middle
still,
rhythm, you know?
Getting it together.
That's one. Then another thing which I had worked on was a French song or a French piece, and we had tried to enact it and perform that in Kathak. So a different language, a different culture. Now Kathak is obviously Indian classical, very traditional. And now if you think of a French song or a French culture, that's completely varied and different. So to bring those two cultures together and try to create something in that
different.
That
sounds really something interesting. I never imagined something like French and Kathak coming together. That's actually sounds really interesting. So that's the kind of stuff we're looking forward to work on. So if there are guys in the audience, if there's any musicians, anyone doing something different, if you want to, you know, get in touch with Parinita, that would be awesome. I'm sure she would love to work on such projects.
Absolutely.
I mean, now we've all been in this lockdown for, I think, around 3 months or more now, I think it's been. So what have you been doing? I mean, I think I read about your online classes where you're like helping people staying fit physically and mentally through yoga, functional training and Pilates, I think, yeah? And how's that been going? And yeah, what else have you been doing?
So, of course, everybody sitting at home, everybody's joints have started rusting. So the whole idea was to start having people to get fit. You have all, because of internet, you know, you're exposed to such different kinds of workout formats and online classes, and everybody's watching it and doing it. And invariably somebody goes like, okay, maybe I overstressed and did something wrong here. So I've pulled this and I've done that. And so the whole point was that, okay, we can watch these videos and definitely work out, but you definitely need some guidance. Somebody to look at what you're doing and tell you whether you're doing it correctly or not. So with that thought, I started with conducting online classes where we were doing yoga, where we are rather doing yoga, Pilates, and functional rehab, and helping people get over their injuries and get fit alongside. So
oh, right, okay.
That's what has been happening.
That sounds really cool, and I think that's very needed as well. I mean, what you said is absolutely right. I mean, you never know when you even injured something and you don't know about it, right? So even that's a little risky. So if you're doing that correct posture, if you have that correct sort of way of doing it, it's always important and good to have someone there. So yeah, I mean, that's great. Helping everybody stay fit and, you know, releasing all those endorphins and staying happy during this lockdown.
Which is also great. Very important, right? Because we're all stuck at home. You need to have some kind of an outlet and make sure that you're okay.
Exactly. So
it's a great way to do that.
So you've also been teaching Kathak since the past 5 years. And how was that experience, like going from Padawan to Jedi? Like, how was that whole transition for you?
Teaching has made me realize that we take our teachers way too granted, you know, for granted that that's the teacher. She, her job is to teach and that's about it. There's nothing more to it. After you start teaching, you start realizing that, oh, there's a lot more to that.
A lot of work.
No student is the same. A lot of work. No one student is the same. You have to, you know, I was actually thinking teaching has become an art form. We should put that in the filter as one of the art forms, because teaching has literally become like an art form. You have to keep on constantly changing and adapting as per the student and their needs, and try to ensure that the knowledge goes and reaches them and, you know, impacts them nicely and correctly. So it's been fun. We've had to shift from offline classes in person in studio classes to online training, which is, again, has been a completely different and new challenge.
Different.
It's been fun.
Yeah.
It's been fun. At least now we can connect to people far, far away also, and, you know, come together.
Yeah,
and do so
that's
much
that's that's been a good advantage. Like, you can also have like one-on-one sessions now, and I think you can like go all over the world. So it's just completely
Absolutely.
Changed that. So that's been a really big positive for a lot of people, even like all other creatives who've been like sort of changed to online, and they've sort of reached so many different countries now with things that they're doing. So I guess that's a very good positive for everyone to like look at. Okay, so now we're going to reach where we've reached release fun round, which is the rapid fire round. And I'm very excited for this because it's just really quick questions and you just have to answer very quickly without thinking.
Okay.
Right, the first thing that comes to mind. So, okay, so we have a few questions. And the first one is, what is the most useless talent you have?
What is the most useless talent I have? Oh, man, I think that would be eating away to glory. I can go on and on and on, and that is the reason why I have to keep on exercising, so that I can stay fit and it should not impact my dance when I'm dancing. But yeah, that's probably one of the most useless talents I have. I can eat and eat and eat and eat.
Right, okay. So what would you, if you had to choose between teaching and learning, what would you choose?
That's a difficult one. That's a very difficult one. But when you start teaching, you'll actually end up learning a lot more than what you would while you were just learning. So I think teaching, because you're invariably doing both in the process.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, so if you could trade lives with anyone for a day, who would it be and why?
Wow, I feel like I'm on Miss India platform or something.
Miss India is a bit much, but right, okay.
Okay, let me think. One person.
It could be anyone, like anyone who's living or not, anybody.
Nowadays, I keep cribbing about the fact that, you know, we're all growing old, and, you know, we can't sort of go back to living our childhood and how it used to be, and, you know, it's such a different thing. Maybe I'll pick going all the way back and becoming a student or a school going child again, and trade lives with them for one day, and then just have a blast, and of course enjoy and learn, and just be
no worries,
different no worries, no stress, no responsibilities, just carefree.
Like the Hakuna Matata time. Yeah, for sure. Okay, so if you could, okay, so I want you to describe yourself in three words.
In three words. Okay. Say hardworking. Say passionate. Dedicated.
Okay,
All good
that's
things. I'm talking about all good
spot
things
on.
about me
Yeah, of course.
now.
Of course. Okay. So, if you had access to a time machine, where and when would you go? But you can't repeat the same answer that you gave before.
Exactly.
No,
Good
you have to
point.
give another one.
Oh God, okay. Where could I go? Again, this is very weird, but I always think of this every time I visit all these architectural monuments, every time I'm on a trip somewhere and I see all these old ruins and I imagine it to be all constructed again, back in its day, how it
Right.
was, all glorious, and also these palaces or forts or whatever, then I imagine myself again standing here, and this would have probably been the court of the king, and this was the space where the dancers may have probably danced, so this was this palace, and if
Right.
I was transported back in time, I could probably go back there and actually recreate that experience for myself. So maybe I'd go back to the whole era where culture was alive and thriving
Right.
in yeah,
Yeah,
and
that's a
enjoy
good answer.
that
That time, yeah, that's pretty good. Okay, so last one. Are you a morning person or night person?
Morning person, definitely.
Okay, great. Okay,
Definitely.
so this is the end of our very pressurizing rapid fire
Rapid
round.
fire.
So the next sort of segment we have is related to the Creator-Coli filter. So for those of y'all who don't know, we have an Instagram filter which we released at the beginning of July. It's basically a generator filter which sort of we want to encourage people with that filter to sort of go beyond your comfort zone, go sort of, like not basically go beyond your comfort zone and sort of get different sort of ideas to collaborate with multiple categories. It could be anybody. Right, so we didn't, cause we are all as creatives, we have this sort of restriction that, okay, I can collaborate with this person, or as a designer, I can collaborate with a musician. But there's so much more that people haven't discovered yet, and there's so many more ideas that we can come up with. So we wanted to encourage that different, idea of thinking that, okay, I can do this, I can do that. So just go crazy with the filter, see what category you get, and maybe you can get in touch with someone from there, and you can, like, things could go to the skies. I mean, the sky's the limit. So yeah, that filter is something that we created, and for this month, all of our creators have used this filter to sort of share some ideas with us on how they would collaborate with the said category that they got. And please, everybody in the audience, do try and use our filter and let us know how it was to tag us. And we hope that you guys get to collaborate much more after using this, and people get in touch with y'all. So, Parinita, you got a script writer as your creative category. Okay, so can you share some ideas with us about yeah, different collaboration ideas?
So if you're having a project in which you're having some sort of a storyline and you're building around it, then it's important to have a script writer on board rather than doing it
Right, so
yourself,
this is
because
in Kathak,
that's
right?
in Kathak, yes. Of course, acting
Right.
bit you can't do without a script writer. You need a
Of
script
course,
to
yeah.
So that is
Yeah.
like, of course. But I'm saying from maybe dance point of view, from Kathak point of view, if we do have a script writer on board, it just makes life easier and a lot more systematic and in a very good structured format, because
Yeah.
your character sketches get a lot better. Then you're able to play out those characters in a much better way, because once it's scripted and once it's put in place, once the story is in place, you can build on characters after that and then start piecing things together.
Right, the
So
flow is sort of much more, I guess, enhanced and, like much more flowy, I guess.
right,
The flow is much more flowy.
yeah,
Yeah.
absolutely. It just becomes a lot more structured than it would be otherwise. So
Right.
working with a scriptwriter, that is, an advantageous point for dancers, definitely, when there is a whole ballet to be performed and there's a story and there's
Yeah,
you know, a lot of links.
right.
So,
That's great. So any scriptwriters in the audience, y'all can just message Parinita and maybe some possible collaborations could happen, and that'll be awesome. So we also actually had Mansi Soni a few sessions back. She's a fashion photographer, and she got a dancer as a collaboration. And she said she's always wanted to sort of capture the portrait of a dancer in motion and, you know, doing what they do. And we spoke about having you come in soon. So she was really interested in that. So maybe hopefully you guys could also collaborate, and that
would
be something
to.
Really
Absolutely.
Nice. Like her
Absolutely.
Vision for that
to.
Project sounds amazing. Like when she spoke it, I could visualize every sort of frame that she was talking about. And I think this project could turn out really cool if you guys wanted it to happen. And
let's
yeah,
make
you
it happen.
That.
Let's make it happen.
Let's make it happen. Yeah, for sure. Okay. So, I mean, like right now, I think as an industry, collaboration has opened up a lot in all creative industries. And a lot of creatives are like going above and beyond, doing some really amazing work. So, for you, I would want to ask you is how do you keep your head in the game and, you know, stay true to your style and your creativity while collaborating on different projects? And I think, yeah, maybe in all your different professions.
I think what is important for me while collaborating is to ensure that I'm not diluting the essence of the art form that I am, putting forth from my end. So if I'm collaborating with any other artist, for example, Kathak with something else, I don't. I wish that the essence of Kathak in its original form, in its purest form, is put out there. That is my only aim and goal while I'm collaborating. That in the process of trying to please the audience or connect with the audience, the art form should not lose its
definitely.
You know what it actually is like.
It's essence,
it shouldn't be
yeah,
so
yeah.
diluted, you know. But that is what I try to ensure it doesn't happen when we are working on projects. But
Wait. So Turio actually commented saying Indian matchmaking upgraded version, but I don't know what you're referring to. Can you please elaborate? I don't know what is it related to. Someone also has a script for you titled The Case of the Missing Pizza. I mean,
wow. Okay. I will definitely work on that case of the missing pizza once the lockdown opens up.
Right.
I also
so
have
that,
a friend
that's
who's
one idea.
Tell them about the NCPA. So another fun performance stories.
Right.
So we were performing at the NCPA for the NCPA dance season, and there were different artists from different backgrounds.
Sorry,
and
one sec.
What
I
a
just
wonderful.
Have to cut you off
yeah.
for a second. Guys, anyone in the audience will have any questions, you can start sending them in. So as soon as Parinita is done with her story, we can start answering a few questions. So you can continue sending in some questions. Yeah, sorry, please continue.
So, we were having this rehearsal in the morning. The show was in the evening, and we were having this run with the whole show floor with all the artists. There were like probably more than 50 artists on that stage that day, some contemporary dancers, some jazz dancers, some Bharatnatyam dancers. It was like a mix, and every style would come, do something and exit, and you know that was the whole process. And in the end there was a fusion of all the dance styles together. So they start playing the music, we come on stage, we get done with our bit, and there is some issue or some problem, and I sort of kind of happen to miss a beat or miss a count, and it just goes completely off because everything is lined up properly.
Ooh,
and I'm supposed
okay.
to exit from one point and enter from the other, and I end up going banging into somebody who's entering from the other side from the wings, and I trip and I'm tripping and falling inside, and the other dancers are like, okay, make space.
Oh my god.
So I'm like, thank God this happened only during the tech run and it did not happen on stage. But yeah, these things are also a part and parcel of, live performances where you have these kind of accidents happening every single time, and especially with somebody like me, I keep on tripping here and there, doing something or the other. Kuch to hote hi
rehta
hai. I
can relate.
So, yeah, so that was another fun.
So that sounds that must have been very scary to imagine that happening at the actual performance.
I was
like,
mortified. Even during the tech run, I was mortified. I was like, oh my god, all these dancers out here, and the director is in the front, and oh my god, I'm going to be so embarrassed now. That it was like, it's fine.
Right. Well, that's fine. Artists don't judge each other, so it's fine. But yeah, okay, so Turio actually explained what he was saying, Akul. Okay, collaboration with other artists, done some. Okay, so you're saying that I am doing Indian matchmaking, an upgraded version. Achha. Are you calling me Seema Taparia from Mumbai? Please.
Oh gosh. Wow.
Okay, so no, that's not going to happen. But that's kind of what we're doing, but please don't say that because we don't judge here, okay, at the Creator Toli. Also, he's also said if you have a rehearsal with some alcohol, is it still called a dry run?
Okay, well, I do not at all advocate that. Ever, ever, ever.
Right.
It's dance something
of course,
is literally like, it's meditative. I wouldn't ever...
Yeah, it's like
when it's a performance and yeah, it's a serious thing. Dry run, tech run, whatever, no way. No way, absolutely not.
Okay, guys, do not do this ever.
Questions.
So, that's done.
Yeah.
Right. So, so there aren't many questions coming in right now. I'm sure people are still sort of coming up with some questions for you. I mean, we've covered so much. So,
yeah. What's your favorite line in Bengali? I don't know much
from
Bengali.
Okay.
Oh, but I do remember something from this. Oh, my God. Yeah. So there was another show which we had gone for when I was very, very young at that point in time, and it was a group, and my seniors from my dance class were a part of this performance, and we'd gone to Delhi for the show, and there were a lot of Bengalis on the troupe, and what fantastic actors, dancers, sorry, what fantastic dancers, and they really, really take their art very seriously. So there's this one dancer who was frantically searching for something, and he kept on running everywhere saying, Amar choti kothai, Amar choti kothai. And we're all wondering, what the hell is he running around looking for? What is choti? Like, he definitely didn't have long hair. And we're like, is he like, you know, looking for a wig? Because is it a part of his act or something? And finally somebody goes to him and asks him, you know, what is choti, boss? Like, what are you saying? And he was like, chappal is choti. I'm like, okay. So, yeah, Bengali, that's probably my favorite line in Bengali, choti kothai. If anybody's a Bengali, please correct
me. Wait, I think I missed that because there was like a sudden, wait, what does it mean exactly? I think it got a little,
choti means chappal, apparently.
Oh, okay, so you're signing as chappal. Oh, God. That was
another
hilarious.
Fun. It was fun,
okay.
Especially when you have a group of friends sitting together and, you know, visualizing or literally watching the scene play out in front of your eyes. It's like, entertainment right there.
Yeah. So someone asked, how can...
Yeah.
Sorry yeah. How can non-artists understand the meaning of, real meaning of art?
How can non-artists understand the real meaning of art? Okay. Be it whichever art form, anything, it's different. It's difficult to understand the technique, of course, if you haven't studied it. But if you're able to connect with that artist, not understand what he's doing, but still connect with that person in terms of how he makes you feel or how she makes you feel when you're watching that art form or that work, is how you can connect with the art. You don't need to really understand what is being done because you don't have enough knowledge about it, but how you feel when you watch it, how you feel when you're seeing it, what kind of emotions are being felt in by you in that moment is how you connect with an artist.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, art is so subjective. Yeah, because even if you're looking at a painting, it's going to mean something different for me and something different for you. I mean, there's nothing really that you can understand about it. It's just how it makes you feel.
Exactly.
And that's like,
feel. Exactly.
That's art. Like, it's just emotion and it's just someone putting themselves out there. So that's
Right.
all that you need to know. So
Right.
yeah. Okay, there was
Right.
another question. Okay, so these questions are like super fast. Hold on. Okay,
Right.
which school did you go to and how was your experience as a dancer?
I studied at Archana Nrityalaya. My guru's name is Srimati Asha Zobrekar, and I studied under her for almost 12 to 15 years, I think. And
Right.
my experience as a dancer, so far so good, and I'm sure it's going to be so because it's something I really, really love and enjoy. It's probably, I literally breathe it. So it's been great. There have been, of course, highs, there have been lows, more lows than highs. As in everybody's life, I'm sure, as everybody's experience, but it's all worth it. It's all worth it if you really enjoy and love what you're doing. So, it's been good so
Yeah,
far.
that's great. So, someone's asking, can you do a bit from the French Kathak fusion dance? Or if not, then where can we watch the performance? I'm sure everyone wants to know that.
I don't have the music right away right now, so that'll be difficult to show it right now. But I can probably upload the link, and then you guys can watch it then, because it's not out there anywhere. It was a live
Please
show,
do.
so I'll have to see if I have some part of it or not. Also, I'm not sure about that, so I'll check it out. And if I have it, I'll definitely put it out there on
Definitely.
my.
Guys, go follow Parinita if you want to stay in touch with all of her different performances and her films and all of that. Because I'm sure, like, I'm just waiting to see everything right now. That's what I'm going to do after this is over. So, okay. So, someone also asked, is there any other dance form that you love performing? Anything other than Kathak? Although you can do it all so perfectly and gracefully. That's really
How sweet.
sweet.
How sweet. Any other dance form that I love to perform? I actually began training in contemporary a couple of years back, but I didn't pursue it because of time and a lot of other things happened at that point in time. But that is another art form which I really, really love, and I wish I can get myself trained in it a little more. I have found two very wonderful teachers also, and I keep texting them that I miss your
Oh.
class, I miss your class, I want to come back to class. But hopefully, sometime in
Yeah.
future, in the near future, I'll be able to do so.
To do it.
Yeah,
Yeah,
there's
for sure.
art, there's contemporary, there's hip hop. Actually, every art form is so difficult. Every dance form, it's so difficult to pick. Whatever I've been exposed to, in whichever dance style I've seen, there is something or the other that you always end up loving and you want to try it out. So,
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah. That's really nice. It's good that you're so like diverse in all the different like dance forms that you learned. Like I think it all sort of helps each other also. You can always, put a bit of this in that here, and that sort of
Oh,
makes
absolutely.
your style
Absolutely.
change completely. So that's cool.
Absolutely.
Someone asked, will you ever do street dance again? Now I did not know you did street dance. That sounds really cool.
That was when I was in Xavier's in junior college. So
Oh,
I
right,
used
okay.
to we used to all participate in dance festivals back then and represent our college, and I was back then a part of the team which did street dance for 2 years, I think. Yeah. That was another very, very fun time, college, junior
Right.
college, where you're, just having a ball of a time dancing. And
Just
yes, I would
time
love to do it again
to
whenever I get the opportunity.
chill. That's great.
Yeah.
That would be awesome to see. I mean, you have to do this.
I do. I
Okay,
think
so.
I have a link of that. I'll definitely share that one.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so someone also asked, which famous Bollywood actor would you like to be? I think it says with, I think. So, which famous Bollywood actor would you like to be with in a rom-com?
Which famous Ranbir Kapoor, without a doubt. He's one of my favorites, and
Right.
I hope someday I'll be able to work with him. So definitely Ranbir
Okay, awesome. Okay, now there's another question. How can one learn different dance styles and be fluent in them without mixing other dance styles which you've been learning?
Kapoor. Discipline, practice, and being able to compartmentalize, and then being able to put them together when you want and keep them separate when you want to. It's not easy. Definitely, it's not easy because you have to unlearn a lot of things while learning something different. Especially if you've
Yeah.
already been learning one particular dance form for a really long time, and then you pick up another one.
Right.
So you have to always be prepared to unlearn what you've learned and then learn it again. But it depends on, it's possible is what I'm trying to say. It's just how you work it out in your mind. But it's possible. Unlearn
Discipline.
and then learn again. Yeah. And discipline. Practice. Practice is the key to it. Just
Practice.
keep practicing, practicing, and practicing.
That's great. Okay. So I think we have like 4 minutes left. So let's quickly sort of wrap this up. So I just want to see her perform Kathak. You guys can follow her on Instagram and see some videos which she'll be putting up, and she already must be having up for sure. And I'm really sorry we didn't get time to show you guys a live performance today, but we just had so much to talk about. So I hope that that's also been enough for everybody watching, and hope you guys had fun. I certainly did. Today was a lot of fun. So just to conclude, what's your most valuable advice that you've received, or something that you would want to share as a dancer, as an actor, just as a in life? What do you, is there something you want to share with everybody as you sort of say bye for today?
Sure. I think the most important advice that I received was at any given point in time was if you really enjoy and love what you do, you'll never find a day where you wouldn't want to do it. Of course, there are times when you want a break from your routine and you don't want to do it every single time, but that comes one of those, you know, on those off days. If you really, really enjoy and love what you do, you'll find a way to do it no matter what. So that was one very good advice that I got, and what I concluded from that in general as to how to look at achieving anything that you want to in life would probably be like, do what you love, love what you do, work really hard, and then just flow along with it. Just flow. Just
Yeah, that's really good
let it
advice.
happen,
And
because then that
yeah.
takes away the stress, because you're open and accepting whatever comes your way in whichever way. But and alongside, of course, you already are loving and enjoying what you're doing, so it causes sort
Yeah,
of
you're not like
creates a
dog-eared and
balance.
saying every Monday, I hate Monday. Like everyone, like if you love what you do, you just wake up and want to do that any point of the time, any point of the day, at any time, and just yeah, want to do it all the day, all the time. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. And I think that's also important for people to reflect, because if you sort of start feeling like you don't like what you do, then maybe you can make some changes in the way you work and the way you sort of, you know, get back to that passion that you felt before. So yeah, that's really good advice from Parinita. Thank you so much for joining us today. It has been so much fun, and you've like answered all of our questions really well. And yeah, even the rapid fire was pretty like really good, even though I had a few challenging questions. And yeah, well,
Thank
thank you
you.
so much for being here, and hope I like, wish you all the best for everything. And guys, please, if you want to collaborate, do get in touch with her, and maybe y'all can work things out. And yeah, hoping for the best. And thank you so much for the audience. You guys have been really nice and such a like amazing, sweet words that you all have sent over to Parinita today.
Absolutely, how sweet.
And
Thank you so much.
yeah, and thanks a lot for being here. Do stay in touch with us if you all want. I mean, if you want to view such live sessions in the future. And other things that we have in store. So yeah, just keep creating, keep collaborating. That's all I want to say. Thank you so much again to everybody who's been here. And namaste. Yeah, thank you so much. See you guys
Thank
soon.
you, thank you.
Bye.